of the Fredericktown United Methodist Church. Ross and Emily are on vacation this week and next week, and so I'll be up front for the announcements today. It's good to see so many of you in the sanctuary, and we welcome all of those that are watching online. And we want to wish a very happy Father's Day to all the dads out there. This morning, we welcome Gary Campbell to deliver our message, and next week, we'll be blessed to hear Andy Clevenger again. Our new pastor, Gail Angel, will begin in 2 weeks on July 4th. This morning, we'll be receiving communion, and I've been asked to tell you if you have the traditional communion cups, as always, they will fit in your cup holder. If you have the goblet-shaped cups, they will not fit in your cup holder, and that's why you have a styrofoam cup in front of you. They can be dropped down in there. The flowers in front of me are given by Richard and Janice with this message. Thank you for 6 wonderful years. We love you all. Richard and Janice did make a very quick arrival to Florida by early Monday afternoon. Richard began work in his new office on Thursday, and Janice had texted me that day, and he was already out visiting people, praying with people. So he's hit the ground running. I've heard from them a few times. Yesterday's text was a picture of Janice relaxing by the pool. So we hope Richard will get to do that at some point, too. Janice expressed a lot of gratefulness for the scrapbook that we put together and for the monetary gift. And she said they can only read a couple pages of the scrapbook at a time before they get emotional. But she appreciates that very much. So with that, I want to remind you that we are also going to put together a book for Gail and Andy Angel as they come. Just if you can write a letter introducing yourself, maybe giving them some of the best kept secrets of Fredericktown, anything you want to do in a letter, and we'll take those this week or next week, or you can leave them in the church office. I know that Richard and Janice would want us to extend the same love to Gail and Andy that we extended to them. Other weekly announcements can be found in the half sheet that's in the narthex. You can also find lots of birthdays and anniversaries there also, and I encourage you to pick one up if you have not done so already. And now will you please stand for our opening prayer? Loving God, you who are our Father, we thank you that you have shown us how important it is to follow your example as we grow in the faith. Teach us to be obedient to your will, respecting you as children ought. Thank you for your mercy despite our disobedience. Strengthen us to stand up against the challenges of this world, honoring your name and trusting your grace. In the name of your Son, we pray. Amen.
And you may stay standing for our first hymn, Faith of Our Fathers, on page 710. We'll do all 3 verses.
Oh, how our hearts
courts with thanksgiving and praise, thanking you for godly influences in our lives. We pray that Pastor Gary's godly wisdom will touch us today. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Now, you can turn to each other and greet each other. Our prayer hymn this morning will be from the hymnal of verse 557, Blessed Be the Tie That Binds, and we'll do the first and three verses.
For both men and women. Those who had a loving father that passed away, those who have never knew their dad, those expectingly waiting to become a dad soon, and countless other situations surrounding the father-child relationship. God can use this day to draw us closer to himself. The one true Father who remains faithful and full of unconditional love. Let us pray. I'm sorry, but I would like all fathers, grandfathers, expected fathers, please stand. We give our thanks, Creator God, for the fathers in our lives. Fatherhood does not come with a manual, and reality teaches us that some fathers excel while others fail. We ask for your blessing for them all and forgiveness where it is needed. This Father Day, we remember the many sacrifices fathers make for their children and family, and the ways both big and small. They lift children to achieve dreams through beyond reach. So too, we remember all those who have helped fill the void from fathers past early or are absent. Grandfathers, stepfathers, uncles, brothers, cousins, teachers, pastors, and coaches, and the women of our family. For those who are fathers, we ask for wisdom, humility, in the face of the task of parenting, give them the strength to do well by children and by you. In your holy name, O God, we pray.
Well, last week was a bittersweet day here at church. 2 weeks ago was a great day in the life of our church. We had 92 golfers representing 23 teams participate in our annual golf outing to support the building fund. Some of our golfers were from our church and many were not. There were low scores, there were high scores, there were teams that did very well, there were teams that struggled, there was one injury, but the winner was the church. We had wonderful support from local businesses and families. 17 businesses did corporate sponsorships, and 6 families did honorary sponsorships. Church families also donated prizes and offered their time to assist with registration and tally up all the final scores. As always, our church family came through with the food. Many of you donated snacks or drinks or made monetary donations, and we had a wonderful crew of volunteers who made sure that the food was purchased, prepared, and served with a smile. Little Apple Golf Course closed their course for us that day. I actually watched them turn away golfers for us. And they made sure that all the golfers were equipped with golf carts, a nice place to eat, and a beautiful golf course on a beautiful day. And we thank Little Apple for that. I could list individual names for all of these jobs, but it wasn't about the individuals. It was a group effort done to benefit the building fund of our church. And I promise you, a good time was had by all. As a group, we were able to raise $4,330 to be put toward the building fund. The golf outing has been a project of the ASAP Sunday School class for the last 3 years. Last year's wasn't scheduled for obvious reasons, but this year's was bigger and better than ever. And next year's has already been scheduled for August 7th, 2022. A couple years ago, other small groups came up with ideas of projects to benefit the building fund. Some were launched, but most were shut down last year. It's time to start brainstorming again and get some more projects up off the ground. I've heard that the choir is throwing around a fun idea, and I encourage you to talk to your small group and think about what your group can do. May's giving to the building fund was nearly $3,000 below our mortgage amount, and our gifts toward operating expenses were also below budget. Hopefully, the golf outing will put June's building fund contributions up over the necessary amount, but it's obvious that we clearly need these extra little boosts. Talk to your people, see what you can do, and I guarantee you, you might even have a good time in the process.
Good morning. This morning, Joy came to me and said, "Are you okay? You don't look like you're doing okay." And I said, "Joy, do you have any idea what Gary asked me to read for scripture this morning?" I said, "I'm nervous." It's got a lot of hard words. So I encourage you just to hear the point of the scripture, not the way I pronounce things, okay? All right, so we're going to read from Judges 4:1-10. After Ehud died, and Israelites once again did evil in the eyes of the Lord, so the Lord sold them into the hands of Jabin, the king of Cana, who reigned in Hazar. The commander of his army was Sisera, who lived in Hazarsheth and Hagarim. Because he had 900 iron chariots and had cruelly oppressed the Israelites for 20 years, they cried to the Lord for help. Deborah, a prophetess, the wife of Lapidoth, was leading Israel at that time. She'd held court under the palm of Deborah between Ram and Bethel in the hill country of Ephraim, and the Israelites came to her to have their disputes decided. She sent for Barak, son of Abdon from Kedesh and Naphtali, and said to him, "The Lord, the God of Israel, commands you, go take with you 10,000 men and lead the way to Mount Tabor. I will lure Sisera, the commander of Jabin's army, with his chariots and his troops to the river and give him into your hands." Barak said to her, "If you go with me, I will go, but if you don't go with me, I won't go." "Very well," Deborah said, "I will go with you, but because the way you are going about this, the honor will not be yours, for the Lord will hand Sisera over to a woman." So Deborah went with Barak, where he summoned Zebulun and Naphtali. 10,000 men followed him, and Deborah also went with him. And then the second reading is from Romans 16:1-4. "I commend to you our sister Phoebe, a servant of the church in Sencera. I ask you to receive her in the Lord in a way worthy of the saints, and to give her any help she may need from you, for she has been a great help to many people, including me. Greet Priscilla and Aquila, my fellow workers in Christ Jesus. They risk their lives for me. Not only I, but all the churches of the Gentiles are grateful to them. May the Lord bless the hearing and the reading of his word.
Thank you very much, Calvary. She spoke to me ahead of time and was concerned about the names in those scripture passages. Thank you very much for that reading. And just a word to the people up at the control. Some of you might have seen me struggling with the lavalier mic. I didn't realize that we had tortured Richard every single Sunday, making him wear that particular lavalier mic. I just simply can't deal with it, so I'll do my best here. And I'm sure they'll cut me off upstairs when I begin to falter. We've already mentioned the fact that Richard and Janice are still thinking of us and praying for us. And I also received a text yesterday from Richard assuring me that I am in their prayers. And of course, I let him know that they are also in our prayers, aren't they? Well, I'm going to go against the culture. On Father's Day, the topic is a mother in Israel. But I will make this nod to Father's Day by reading for you Bob's last letter. Dear friends, men must remember that as women grow older, it's harder for them to maintain the same quality of housekeeping. When men notice this, they should try not to yell. Let me relate how I handle the situation. When I took early retirement, it became necessary for Nancy to get a full-time job. Shortly after she started working, I noticed she was beginning to show her age. I usually get home from fishing about the same time she gets home from work. Although she knows how hungry I am, she almost always has to rest before supper. I try not to yell. Instead, I tell her to take her time and just wake me up when she does get supper on the table. She used to do the dishes as soon as we finished eating. Now they sit several hours after supper. I do what I can by reminding her each evening they aren't cleaning themselves. I know she appreciates this, as it does seem to help her get them done before she goes to bed. It also gives her more time to do things like shampooing the dog, vacuuming and dusting. And if I've had a good day of fishing, it allows her to gut and scale the fish at a more leisurely pace. Now, I know I probably look like a saint in the way I support Nancy. However, guys, if you just yell at your wife a little less because of this letter, then writing it is worthwhile. Signed, Bob. Couple of footnotes. Bob's funeral was on Saturday. Nancy was acquitted on Monday. Yes, I've chosen to go against the culture of the day instead of giving a Father's Day sermon to preach a message on a mother in Israel. I've often thought the Bible is at its very best when it goes against its culture. The Bible, after all, both Old and New Testaments were written in a time when the culture was patriarchal and chauvinistic. That was a characteristic of the ancient Near East and of Israel itself. And yet the Bible has many, many examples of female leadership. This phrase, a mother in Israel, describes a very wise woman. You can read about her in 2 Samuel chapter 20. She saved her city by her wisdom. In a time of warfare, she saved the city because she was a wise person, a mother of Israel. And then, of course, the lesson that was read from the book of Judges describes Deborah, a mother of Israel. You who are students of the Bible realize that after the people of Israel had gone into the promised land and before they had a king, local leaders would be raised up by the Lord. We call them judges, and you read about them especially in the book of Judges. After sin, they might be oppressed by their enemy, and God would raise up one of these judges to deliver the people and bring them back again to their senses as the people of God, those who worship Him and Him only. Well, Deborah was the fourth in the list of judges in the book of Judges. We read about Shamgar, and I don't know a blessed thing about Shamgar except his name is here. We read about Gideon. We all know a little bit about Gideon. But between Shamgar and Gideon, there is Deborah. And Judges chapter 2 and chapter 3 are dedicated to this outstanding female leader. Chapter 3 is the Song of Deborah. And in the 5th chapter and verse 7, I read this in the about the Song of Deborah. The peasantry prospered in Israel. They grew fat on plunder because you arose, Deborah. You arose as a mother in Israel, an outstanding leader, female gender, in this part of the Old Testament. The rabbis listed seven women whom they regarded as prophets. One was Sarah, the wife of Abraham, the mother of Isaac. One was Miriam, the sister of Moses, who along with Aaron and Moses was a leader of the people of Israel as they went toward the promised land. One, of course, was this Deborah that we've just spoken about. One was Hannah, the mother of Samuel, the first great prophet in Israel. One of the prophets listed by the rabbis was Abigail, a very wise woman who became a wife of King David and by her wisdom protected David from the Lord's wrath, guiding him in the straight and narrow way. And one, of course, was Esther. Just think of it. In this patriarchal society, the Old Testament has two books about women and named for women, Esther and Ruth. And Esther is the queen who saved the Jews at the establishment of the festival of Purim. Esther is a prophet. And then the one that I did not mention, Huldah. Huldah was a contemporary of Jeremiah. Jeremiah was one of the great prophets, and of course we have his book in the Old Testament. But when King Josiah needed the Lord's guidance, he sent people not to Jeremiah, but to Huldah. She was a mother of Israel. You can read about her in 2 Kings chapter 22 and 2 Chronicles chapter 34. Well, now we come into the New Testament. And beginning with Jesus, and all through the New Testament church, there is a radical view of women. Women leaders, female leaders. Again, the culture was the exact opposite. The Bible is countercultural in this respect. In that culture, both in Jewish world and the Gentile world, a woman was regarded primarily as the property of her father and then of her husband. She was there for a man's pleasure, to raise his children and to cook his meals, and she needed to be spot on perfect in all those regards, or she would risk an easy divorce from that man. But not with the church and not with Jesus. Oh, I know, he had 12 disciples who were men, and 11 of them became apostles. But are you aware of the fact that there were many women who provided for Jesus and his company? Read Matthew 27, verse 55, and Luke chapter 8, verses 1 through 3. He healed men, of course, the blind and the lame. But Jesus raised a daughter from the dead. He healed a woman who had suffered many things from many physicians, who suffered 12 years in hemorrhaging. And the story that I find most moving to myself is the compassion he showed to the bent over woman. Can you imagine going through life and not being able to stand straight? And the compassion of the Savior, who saw her as a daughter of Abraham and brought a healing and a relief to all of her suffering. Well, the book of Acts begins with the day of Pentecost, the descent of the Holy Spirit. It was the fulfillment of Joel chapter 2, which foretold that the Spirit of God would rest not only on the men, but on the women. The men servants and the maid servants, all of any position whatever in society, might receive the fullness of the Holy Spirit and know the love of God dwelling within the heart. And then there's that missionary couple, Priscilla and Aquila. It occurs to me that Priscilla's name is always given first. I wonder why that was. I don't think it was just being polite. She was the leader in that missionary couple, and together they even instructed one of the great evangelists of the day, Apollos, who was a wonderful preacher, but needed to know the way of the Lord more perfectly. And so Priscilla and Aquila taught him about the fullness of the Spirit of God. St. Paul's mission then moves on. And on his second missionary journey, he has a vision and hears the Macedonian call. He's forbidden to preach anymore in Asia, so he crosses the waters into Macedonia and brings the gospel into Europe in that way. And he meets a wealthy businesswoman whose name is Lydia. And she urges him and his company to regard her home as their headquarters. Could anyone doubt that she was the leader of the church in Macedonia? At the end of the book of Acts, Paul and his company are moving back into Jerusalem. And they visit along the way, an overnight visit with Philip. A few weeks ago, our pastor, Richard, referred to this story. And you may remember, if you were here at that time, he asked what if anyone knew about Philip's family. I happen to know that. Philip had four daughters, and the Bible says they were all prophets. prophets. Now, you may wonder if we ought to call a female prophet a prophetess. But the Bible simply says they are prophets. And you can't persuade me that a prophet didn't get up and preach sometimes and proclaim the word that God had given her. Four prophets in that one household. And then we get to that New Testament lesson, Romans chapter 16. It's, of course, a chapter full of greetings because Paul has already written the book of Romans, and now he's just greeting people. And among those whom he greets are, of course, Priscilla and Aquila once again. But especially I take note of a woman named Phoebe. It's an interesting Greek word that describes her, prostatis. It could mean helper or protector or presider. Evidently, Phoebe was the presiding officer of the church, as Paul greets them there in Romans chapter 16. A little bit later on, past our scripture reading today, he also greets Andronicus and Junia, and he says, they're my relatives. They evidently were cousins. Andronicus the man, Junia his mother. And Paul says, they were in Christ before me. And he gives his praise to Junia, a female believer who was a leader of the people of Israel, a mother of the church. Well, now, I know some of you are perhaps going to think, why did Paul tell Corinthian women they couldn't speak in church? And if they had a question, they needed to go home and ask their husbands and get an answer that way. I'm not exactly sure, but I think most of us believe that there was a specific situation in Corinth. And remember, Corinth was a church that gave Paul a lot of difficulty. He was concerned about their welfare in many different ways. But evidently, it was a situation of chaos in their church meetings. And so he thought Corinthian women should not contribute to the chaos and the disorganization of those meetings. I was a district superintendent in the New England Conference, and so we were recommending people to the Board of Ordained Ministry to be ordained. And there were, of course, a couple of women who were going to be ordained and were recommended by me, their district superintendent. And one of the other members of the Board of Ordained Ministry, who knew very well my conservative and orthodox leanings, said, but Reverend Campbell doesn't believe that women should speak in church, does he? And my answer was, that's right, Corinthian women. Corinthian women might not want to speak in church, but do you know the interesting thing about that Corinthian situation is that already Paul had talked about women as well as men prophesying. That comes before he said the women shouldn't speak up. It says a woman ought to have a symbol of authority on her head when she prays in public or prophesies. So there's a little mixed witness there in the book of Corinthians. And yet Paul is fully ready to recognize that a woman might pray or might prophesy in public. Paul's final statement on this whole topic, of course, we find in Galatians chapter 3. Listen to these words. As many of you as were baptized into Christ have clothed yourselves with Christ. There is therefore no longer Jew nor Greek, no longer slave nor free, no longer male or female, for all of you are one in Christ. And so you are Abraham's offspring, heirs according to the promise. Women as well as men, children of Abraham and heirs of the promise. Now, I've put together a good bit of the biblical witness on this subject. And what we believe is based strictly on the Word of God. This certainly is our authority. We understand that God's truth is revealed in Holy Scripture. We turn to three other sources to help us understand all that it is talking about. It's revealed in Scripture, but it is illumined by tradition. It is vivified, made alive, and experienced, and it is confirmed by reason. So very briefly, let's examine each one of those three arms. Tradition. The Bible's witness is illumined by tradition. I could name many names of female leaders of the church down through 2,000 years. I think immediately of Hildegard of Bingen, a spirit-filled woman known especially for being able to sing the praises of God in her unknown tongue. I think of Teresa of Avila, who wrote a book, The Interior Castle, and describes the workings of the human soul as the levels of a castle, a wonderful book. I think of a woman named for Teresa of Avila, Thérèse of Lisieux. I've read her Diary of a Soul. She had what she called the little way, and she would gather all the services that she could offer in one day and give them as a bouquet to the Lord Jesus. What a wonderful woman she was. I think of Julian of Norwich. I've made a special study of this one. 13th century, the first woman to write a book in the English language. The book was called Showings. When I first read it, it was the old spelling, S-H-E-W-I-N-G-S. Revelations, and she shows how God had revealed himself to her. And some years ago in the mid-90s, I was able to go to England, actually go to Norwich, and go to the church where she lived in a cell in a small room in the back of the church. And I sat in that room for a couple of hours, seeming to commune with the spirit of this godly woman who was sought out by many for Christian counsel, Julian of Norwich. Early in my life, I read the books of Hannah Whitall Smith, The Christian Secret of a Happy Life, and The God of All Comfort. Those are her two titles. What a great understanding she had of the fullness of the Spirit of God that is offered to every one of us. And then I think of another Phoebe, not the one in Paul's letter, Phoebe Palmer, who was one of the founders of the holiness movement in America. And that, of course, came directly out of the Methodist Church, with the emphasis that John and Charles Wesley made on Christian holiness. Camp Syker, not far away, is one of the holiness camp meetings produced in the midst of the holiness movement. Phoebe Palmer is the name. I mentioned John and Charles Wesley. Well, of course, they were our fathers. But what about their mother, Susanna Wesley, who raised 18 or 19 children and educated them all on her own until they went off to public school, and who many times counseled her son John toward a better way and what God would have them do. Speaking of tradition, right here in Fredericktown, Ohio, there's already a tradition. I don't know if you know about this or not. I came across the Knox County Citizen for the 12th of January in 1961. And one of the articles there was telling us that the Church of God had asked their pastor to reconsider and stay with them. Their pastor was Reverend Florence Moon. Florence Moon. I didn't know her, but she's part of the tradition. She had taken a call to another church, and her church here loved her so much, they asked her to reconsider, and she did. She stayed here. Part of our tradition, Reverend Florence Moon. What about experience? These truths of the Bible are made alive in experience, certainly in my own experience, because one of the women who preached when I personally went forward to kneel at an altar as a seeker was a woman named Janie Bradford. She was the youth preacher over at Camp Syker, but all the adults flocked to hear Janie Bradford. Strong, powerful, spirit-filled woman who proclaimed the truth of God in a way that touched my heart and made a difference forever in my own life. I've had two associate pastors who were female. Both of them could preach. And then I remember a young woman who asked for counseling time, and I met with her in the pastor's study, I don't know how many times, a few times. She was already an accomplished school teacher and dramatist. She already had a master's degree, but something about her life was not satisfying to her. And at some point, I have no idea why, except for the Spirit of God, I said to her, "Why don't you go to seminary?" And her response was, "How did you know?" She had felt a call to preach when she was a little girl, but she was in a denomination that instructed her that women cannot preach. So she had gone all her life up to that time thinking she could not answer that inward call. So she began taking part-time courses at seminary. Then she resigned from her preaching position and went full-time. And she's had a wonderful, fruitful ministry in the state of New York all the rest of her adult life. It comes alive for me when I read the Bible about all the female leadership that was there. And so, of course, is it reasonable? It's not reasonable to me that God would call someone to preach if he didn't mean they should, and if he didn't think they could. Why would God call anyone to preach if they weren't intended in his plan to be a proclaimer of the gospel and a presider over the church? I think it was the year 1986. There was a convention, I won't name the denomination because I don't mean to be critical of any other group, but the speaker was introduced and there was quite a commotion as three or four of the rows right in front of the podium got up, turned their chairs the other way to indicate they did not approve of the person who was going to preach. That woman was Ann Graham Lotz, Billy Graham's daughter. And Billy Graham himself said, "Ann is the best preacher in the family." And she preached, but she preached over the objections of quite a few of her hearers. Some years later, Ann Graham Lotz was interviewed by Larry King. And he asked her if she was worried because the leaders of her denomination did not approve of her as an ordained pastor. She said, "Larry, I don't believe I'm accountable to them. Larry, I don't believe I'm accountable to them. She was accountable to the God who called her and gifted her so wonderfully as one of the great preachers of our day. In 2 weeks, we will rejoice to welcome Gail Angel as our pastor. I'm looking forward to it. Are you? Why? Because she's authenticated by the scriptures. I know that the tradition is all in favor of what she is and what she will be for us. I know that my own experience will be enlivened because of her ministry. And it would be totally unreasonable, irrational of me to post any objection, whatever. We're going to receive communion today as we conclude this service. And this is the invitation. Pray for our new pastor as you receive the bread and as you receive the cup. If you have the little cups that were handed, the bottom one has the bit of bread, and the top one then you can take off the peeling on the top at the time of the cup. Just that much mechanics so that you will be comfortable with what we are about to do. I would like you to take your hymn book, please, and turn to page 15 in the front of the hymn book. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. And we do give you thanks, God our Father, the great Father of all, and especially for our own fathers on this earth, and for the privilege that many have of becoming a father, a grandfather, even a great-grandfather. But especially we praise you for the faith of our fathers and mothers in the church. We praise you for the great acts of salvation all down through the sacred record of the scriptures, the way in which you used a woman like Deborah to bring release, forgiveness, prosperity to your people, the way that you would use a woman like Phoebe to preside over your church. And so, with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn, Holy, Holy, Holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. We thank you especially, O God, for the coming of a Savior, Jesus of Nazareth, the Christ, the one anointed as the Son of God and sacrificed for the sins of the whole world. We praise you for his healing ministry, for his sublime teachings. Today, especially, we praise you that whether male or female, he offered his call, his blessing, and his spirit to all. And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us. As we proclaim the mystery of faith, Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Now, O God, we praise you for the presence of your Holy Spirit. And we ask that your Spirit will descend upon these gifts, the bread and the cup, and upon us gathered here out of love for you, that we might know the saving work of the Redeemer and might become more and more faithful servants of the great good news. All honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. We pray the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Jesus, on the night that he was betrayed, took bread and blessed it and gave it to them, saying, "Eat this, all of you. This is my body broken for you. Let us receive this gift with faith and thanksgiving, and offer our prayers for the future ministry of our congregation." After the supper, Jesus took a cup and blessed it and gave it to them, saying, "Drink of this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Let us receive this gift with thanksgiving and faith and surround it with our prayers for the future ministries of our church." Now, O God, we give you thanks once again for this holy sacrament, these visible reminders of an invisible grace, pointing us to the one sacrifice of Calvary, adequate for the sins of the whole world, and the love of the God who gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. We have received the sacrament today, Lord, thinking especially of our leader soon to come, and pray your rich blessing upon Pastor Gail and upon her husband, Andy. Pray that the parsonage home will be a place of joy and peace, and that this congregation will continue and increasingly be a place of light in our community and in our world. Hear our prayer, we who are your body, redeemed by your blood, and we give you thanks through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Our final hymn is "Help Us Accept Each Other," on page 560, and we'll do all four verses. Help us accept each other as Christ accepted us. Teach us as sister, brother, each person to embrace. Be present, Lord, among us, and bring us to believe. We are ourselves accepted and meant it to then live. Teach us, O Lord, your lessons as in our daily life we struggle to be human and search for hope and faith. Teach us to care for people, for all, not for some, to love them as we find them or as they may become. Let your acceptance change us so that we may be moved in living situations to do the truth in love, to practice your acceptance until we know by heart the table of forgiveness and laughter's healing art. Lord, for today's encounters with all who are in need, who hunger for acceptance, for righteousness and bread, we need new eyes for seeing, new hands for holding on. Renew us with your Spirit, Lord, free us, make us.